hunger, all of these things, and then you're not in your comfort zone. You're not outside your house. You're away. The ziyarat and the zariyah of Sayyidina Shuhada, you're allowed to be prayerful, you have the choice. It is considered to be as if it is your second house. But nonetheless, because you're on this journey and you're already traveling and you're already tired and you have the hunger and the thirst and all these things, and then when you get pushed around, it is possible that some of our bad traits might come up. So that is the point, to go ahead and show the best of your behavior. During ziyarat, because of large crowds, congestions, limited resources, unforeseen problems arise, which can easily disturb the event, you know, of what you're going on. And even the most calmest of the people, those who are not even known for any aggression, even they might become agitated at that time. So when that happens, if you show that you're composed, you are as if that ayat of Quran, which I recited for you, Surah Tawbah 120. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said what? He said, La yusibuhum zama'un, wala nasabun, wala makhmasabun. That they won't feel thirst, hunger, or fatigue, except it is considered to be what? Amal salih. Guess what? When you feel fear, hunger and thirst and fatigue, and you're pushed around, and you're feeling in this sort of that, you know, people are not behaving well, your good behavior considered is, becomes what? Amal salih, in front of the behavior that people are showing. So that's number one, as far as our six imams, advice is concerned for those who are going for ziyarat. Number two, imam said, قِلَّةُ الْكَلَامُ إِلَّا بِخَيْرٍ. Speak less unless it's good speech. Well, we have many riwayat regarding speech as well. مَرْءُ مَقْبُونْ تَحْتَى لِسَانِهِ, right? The person is concealed behind his or her tongue. The moment you open your mouth, your good and bad is understood. Other than that, your good and bad is hidden and concealed. Does it speak less unless it's good speech? Many of these things that we say during our free time has no benefit whatsoever and usually are in vain. And there is little or no good in it. Therefore, it is incumbent upon the zahir of imam to control his tongue from useless speech. This travel is a great opportunity for one to purify their nafs by controlling and purifying their tongue and by going into seclusion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seclusion in ziba is not permissible when you are over here. Nobody asks you to seclude yourself away from the community. That is not a lifestyle which is mentioned or recommended by Ayman al-Tah. But when you are there for ziyarat for 10 days, go into seclusion. Go into this inziba where nothing bothers you. No one bothers you. You are connecting directly through this wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and have this direct connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So enrich your soul with the dhikr, with Quran, with supplication, with the ziyarah, with the adhiyah and the dua, and make this ziyarah to be the best of the ziyarah. But you should also avoid, well, it says to speak less unless it's a good speech, which is already telling you that you should always be avoiding lying and backbiting and gossiping. And even, you know, when you're not on a spiritual journey, outside of a spiritual journey, these things are something which have to be avoided. There's much to say about this. I'll refrain from going into, otherwise I won't get to all of the advices that our sixth imam has given. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Allah.
And some people believe that certain things are allowed at times, but then become forbidden at other times. This is not always true. And I said this is not always true, but many times this is true. If something is haram in normal circumstances, it'll remain haram at all times. Temporarily, something might become halal for you. I mean, as the ayah today, Maida says, you know, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ, you know, دَمُ وَلَحْمُ خِنْزِيرُ وَمَا أُهِلَّ. All these things are haram upon you. Except when what? Except when you are in danger of dying. You don't have any food, so you're dying. These things become permissible for you. But majority of time, things remain haram. For example, when we're speaking about here, when we impose things as haram upon us. During Ayyami Azam, people think they're listening to music is haram. Well, listening to music is haram during Ayyami Azam. It's haram even outside of Ayyami Azam. So it's not something to do with the respect of Ayyam al-Azam. Well, Muharram is going on, so right now I'm going to throw away all my tapes and cassettes and CDs and my MP3 players or my USB, whatever it is that the kids are using, players that are out there, I'm 80s till the 90s and the 2000s. I brought all of those things in. You know, they put them all away until Ayyan al-Adha are over. They check out the devices where there's noha on it. They listen to the noha during these days in the spirit of Imam Hussein and the companions and shuhada, and they elevate their souls by listening to these nohas, which are definitely moving them, these elegies. But the moment Ayyan al-Adha are over, put these back again, inshallah, we'll check them out next year. So that these things are haram during Ayyam al-Adha. Out of respect, you're removing it. It should remain haram even outside of Ayyam al-Adha. Well, as we said, there are many things that are vice versa, which in exceptional cases may become halal for you temporarily. But this isn't one of those things. Number three. So I won't dwell too much onto it, as it'll take a lot of time. Number three. The third advice that our sixth imam in this lengthy hadith, which you can find in Kabul Ziyarat, page number 131, he said, remembering Allah and the doing the dhikr often. Not just doing the dhikr, but doing the dhikr often. Kafratu dhikrillah. Dhikr and remembrance of Allah has constructional effects. Sometimes we take it for granted. It has constructional effects. Dhikr and remembrance of Allah, you know, has this effect on our souls. The same way these melodies and music has effect on the souls, guess what? Dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also has profound effect on you, ethically speaking, for mankind, especially during ziyarah. When a person is in the close vicinity of awliya Allah, it illuminates the hearts, provides comfort, instills fear of disobedience, of forgiveness from sins, and knowledge and wisdom are some of these effects that emerge just by constantly doing the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salaam alayhi Muhammad.
Allah.
Of course, hearts are at ease. Number four is cleanliness of libas. Imam said, nadhafatul thiyab. When you go for ziyarah, they show that you are pure. External purity is easy to achieve these days. You know, you go and you stay in a hotel that are equipped with showers, and you can clean yourself and put on nice clothes, especially in modern times when most people have access to clean water. Internal purity is lifelong challenge. But guess what? You know, there's a shortcut for majority of the things. If there's a shortcut for this internal purity, then it's this 10-day journey to Kafanat. You take upon this journey and you immerse yourself completely into the ambience and the fada of this environment that Imam Hussein is bearing and the shuhada's pure blood is mixed with the sand of that land, and you're in that environment right away that gives you that quick opportunity to perform this internal purity, to have a pure heart that is pleasing to our Lord. We must then control our thoughts, our desires, and our actions. Prophet of Islam, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَإِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةً إِذَا صَلَحَتْ وَإِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبُ. He said, verily, the body is a piece of flesh, which, if sound, the entire body is sound. But if it's corrupt, then the entire body is corrupt. Truly, it is your heart. So the heart has to remain clean and pure. No matter how much you purify the externally yourself, if the heart internally is not pure, then of course it does not benefit a great deal. Number five, performing ghusl before entering the marqad of Imam. This is one of the mustahabat of the ziyarah. Comes right out of the book of Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. He went for the ziyarah, first ziyarah of Imam. When he went for the ziyarah, what did he do the first thing? He didn't just jump to the zari of Imam. At their time, who knows, zari was just a grave of Sayyidina Shuhada. He didn't go directly to the zari, although there was no stoppages. There weren't any security personnel sitting, or he has to go through any sort of, you know, screening or whatever. But he stopped. He delayed it. He did ghusl first in Qurat, and then he moved and he took every step to the ziyarah of the zari, or the grave of Imam. And when Atiyah asked him, "O Jabir, aren't you a friend of Hussein? Aren't you longing for the ziyarah of his? Why are you taking so much of your time?" Is that if you only knew that every step that I take toward the ziyarah of Sayyidina Shuhada There's a written for me, ibadat, you cannot even enumerate if you want to go ahead and count them. So, ghusl, qabla an ta'tiyan ka'abir. This is a sunnah of Jabir. So go ahead and perform the ghusl before you enter the ha'ir of Sayyid al-Shuhada. Number six, at-tawqiru li-akhdi ma laysa lak. I'll go through this quickly as I've run out of my time. Maintaining dignity and in refraining from receiving what does not belong to you is important too. Helping the zawab. Imam also refers to it. He said, يَلْزِلُكَ أَن تَعُودَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِ الْحَادَةِ مِنْ إِخْوَانِكَ إِذَا رَأَيْتَ مُنْقَطِعًا وَالْمُعْصَى. It is important while you are capable of taking care of yourself, but helping out strangers over there, those who also like you have traveled many miles to come from the ziyarah of Imam Hussein, and now they're in need of something, they should go out of your way to go ahead and help them out. Same way, when you come here in the Ayyam Azad during the Majalis, when you were commemorating the first 10 days, the first 10 nights, an overwhelming crowd is coming in, right? People that you haven't seen from all walks of life are coming in, all for the love of Imam Hussein, not for my love, or not for your love, not for the people, not for the doctor, not for any of these things. They are coming only for Imam Hussein. So they all become what? They become the zawwab and the guest of Sayyid al-Shuhada. How would you treat your own personal guests when they come to your house? You should treat the same way, if not better, those who are the guests of Sayyid al-Shuhada, Imam al-Sahab al-Salam. So Imam says it is important that you assist and address the issues of those who are in need. And then, of course, there are certain etiquettes after completion of ziyarah. Only two I'll mention, and I'll conclude. Number one, dua when bidding farewell. Whenever you visit Imam and you wish to leave his presence, then throw yourself onto his grave or cling onto his zari and kiss it and read the ziyarah. As-salamu alayka ya maulaya, as-salamu alayka ya hujjatullah. There are many different ziyarah that are mentioned for the wida of Sayyid al-Shuhada. Be sure that you do this wida.
Allah.
Kalima in it, that don't consider this to be my last visitation to you, O Imam. Make me come back again so I can perform the ziyarah once again. And number two, bring gifts for others. Most have to bring souvenirs for family and friends, but not by spending hours and hours in the bazaar and the marketplace, which sacrifices the time that we should be spending in order to perform the ziyarah of Sayyid al-Shuhada. Hopefully, these two points that we mentioned will help you make this ziyarah a better experience for yourself and more spiritually uplifting, as well as with the ma'rifah of Imam in the Hadith. وَأَبْلَهُ لِذَبْتِ أَبْلَهِ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ الشَّيْطَانِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ وَالْأَصْلِ إِلَّا الْإِنسَانِ وَفِي الْفُسْرِ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ.